Can we start now? Yes. Pregnancy is a peculiar physiological state in which many changes take place. Most of these changes are due to the effect of pregnancy hormones. Maternal physiological changes help adaptation of the woman's body to pregnancy. Understanding these changes is essential for discriminating between a normal pregnancy symptom and those related to pathological conditions. Number two, understanding the effect of pregnancy on pre-existing disease, diabetes or heart disease. Diagnosis of pregnancy was previously dependent on finding some of these changes before the evolution of ultrasonography and the accurate pregnancy test. The first maternal change is a genital change. A, the body of the uterus. The height of the uterus increases from 7.5 cm to reach 35 cm at term due to estrogen and progesterone leading to a myometrial hypertrophy and hyperplasia. Number two, second, the contents of the uterus, fetus, placenta, amniotic fluid. The weight increases from 50 grams to reach 100 grams at term, 1 kilogram. The shape of the uterus is globular till the 14th week, then it becomes biriform. The uterine ligament show hypertrophy. Takes rotation. The uterus is lifted and twisted to the right in 80% of cases. Braxton Hicks contraction. A regular painless contraction to help the placental circulation. B, the lower uterine segment. The lower uterine segment is formed from the isthmus. It starts to be formed from the 4th month to reach 10 cm at full term. Obstetric significance of the lower uterine segment. The site of a lower segment, caesarean section. Site of rupture of obstructed labor. Site of implantation in cases of placenta previa. The differences between upper and lower uterine segment. Upper uterine, start by the upper uterine segment and next is the lower uterine segment. During labor, it is active, the upper segment is active, i.e. it contracts and retracts to become shorter and thicker. You have to know what is meant by retraction. Retraction that any muscle in the body, when it contracts, is shortened. When it relaxes, it is lengthened. But in the uterine muscles, when it contracts, it never returns to its original length. It is always shorter than the original length. Thick wall, it contains three muscle layers, upper segment. Upper segment is thick wall, it consists of three muscle layers. Outer longitudinal, middle oblique forming figure of 8, for hemostasis. The figure of 8, when contracted, it will close any big vessels, and so it controls the bleeding, especially postpartum bleeding. The inner circle, if you have 3 layers, outer longitudinal, and the middle oblique forming the 8, forming the figure of 8 for hemostasis of the placental bed. The inner circle, covered by atrant peritoneum. The membrane are firmly attached. يعني الكوريان and the amnion are firmly attached to the upper segment. We are going now to discuss the characteristic of the lower uterine segment. During labor, it is passive, i.e. it dilates and stretches to be thinner and longer. This is opposite to occasive in the upper segment. Yeah, during labor, the lower segment lengthened, the upper segment shortened. Thin wall, lower segment is thin wall. The oblique layer is defective, so the lower uterine segment shows less retraction. Covered by loose peritoneum. The membranes, the chorion and the abdomen are loosely attached. This is the upper segment, and the uterus. I'm going to speak about the cervix. What occurs in the cervix? Edema and congestion. It becomes soft, the so-called Goodell sign, and the bluish Chadwick sign. Neglect these names. It's not important. You have to do that. The cervix becomes edematous, congested, and bluish in color, and soft. Mucus plug, which consists of cervical mucus, closely closing the cervical canal. This is very important because it protects the pregnancy from ascending infection from the vagina. Hormonal erosion may occur. The hormonal erosion means the cervix is everted, external os of the cervix is everted, exposing the columnar epithelium of the endocervix. Columnar epithelium is thin, and so the blood vessels become apparent and give the external os the red color. This is called erosion or ectropion. This disappears spontaneously to 3 to 6 months after labor. The fourth change in the cervix is cervical ripening, mainly at the end of pregnancy. Due to edema, decreased collagen caused by prostaglandins. And this is very important because if you want to induce labor, you have first to ripe the cervix. How to ripe the cervix? We give her local prostaglandin in the vagina. This will ripen the cervix. Ripen of the cervix, yeah, it becomes shorter, becomes soft, becomes dilated. As regards the vulva, the vulva shows increased vascularity and varicosities may develop. And this change makes the vulva of the pregnant woman liable to 2 things. Any trauma will cause severe bleeding for the vulva. Any trauma will cause hematoma of the vulva. As regards the vagina, shows increased vascularity and makes it soft and moist and bluish and hot. The vagina during pregnancy is very hot, which very hot, hotter than non-pregnant. The ovary shows increased vascularity and increased size. Once the ovaries contain the corpus luteum, which degenerates after the 10th week. It degenerates when the placenta develops and secrete progesterone. We need it in the first 10, the corpus luteum, we need it in the first 10 weeks because the placenta has not developed no progesterone, and progesterone is very important for the progress and prevent the contraction of the uterus to maintain pregnancy. And this, the patient of the pregnant woman takes it from the corpus luteum. When the placenta develops and secretes progesterone, this the corpus luteum will degenerate. This occurs at 10 weeks pregnancy. As regards the breast changes, these are very important. These changes for the breast were used to diagnose pregnancy. But now diagnosis of pregnancy is very easy by a stick. Put a stick in the urine. In 2 minutes, if you have 2 lines, this patient is pregnant. If you have 1 line, the patient is not pregnant. But these changes we used in the past for diagnosis of pregnancy. Now, it is not important because of the development of sticks. Diagnostic for pregnancy. These sticks may diagnose pregnancy before the missed period. Breast changes due to effect of estrogen and the progesterone. Increase the size and the vascularity, warm, tense, and tender. The breast increase in size or vascularity, become warm, tense, and tender. Second areola appears light pigmentation around the areola. Montgomery tubercles appear in the areola. Montgomery tubercles, what are these? They are dilated sebaceous glands. Colostrum-like fluid is expressed at the end of the 4 months. Skin changes. The skin general changes. Pigmentation. Melanocyte stimulating hormone, the estrogen. This pigmentation is caused by melanocyte stimulating hormone and the estrogen. They are increased and high during pregnancy. The number one of this pigmentation is the so-called linea nigra. Pigmentation of the linea alba, more marked below the umbilicus. Colosma gravidarum, a butterfly pigmentation of the face. Stereo gravidarum, so-called stretch marks. These are pink lines in the flanks due to rupture of the subcutaneous elastic fiber. As a result of the stretch of the abdominal wall during pregnancy by the enlarging uterus. After labor, the color turns white due to fibrosis and is called stereo albicans. Albican means white. Less loss of hair, a common complaint that occurs during pregnancy. These are the skin changes. Metabolic changes. Protein metabolism, anabolic changes. Tendency for nitrogen retention and increase the binding globulin produced by the liver. We have many binding globulins, 6 or more binding globulins, corticosteroid binding globulin, androgen binding globulin, and so on. But a progressive increase in insulin requirement due to unseen antagonism and resistance. A common change in pregnancy is so-called insulin resistance. What do we mean by insulin resistance? We mean that the secreted insulin during non-pregnant state is quite sufficient for the metabolism. During pregnancy, the metabolism increases, and so it needs more oxygen, more insulin. Insulin resistance means the patient cannot use its glucose. The glucose will rise in the blood, level of glucose in the blood, and so it will pass to the fetus. Because the main nutrition of the fetus is by glucose. Progressive increase in insulin requirement due to insulin antagonism and resistance. What causes this insulin resistance? Placental hormones, especially human placental lactogen, estrogen, and progesterone. Production of insulinase enzyme by the placenta. This insulinase enzyme will destroy the insulin, and so the body cannot use it. Another important change is alimentary glycosuria due to rapid absorption of glucose from the gastrointestinal tract. During pregnancy, the rapid increase of the glucose from the gastrointestinal tract, because this glucose, as we said before, is very important for the growth and development of the fetus. And the main nutrition of the fetus, especially the brain, is for by glucose. Placental renal glycosuria. Due to lowering of the renal threshold, increased loss of glucose in the urine. A renal threshold for non-pregnant is 180 mg DL. Above this, it will pass in the urine. Here, for pregnancy, 140 mg DL will allow urine to pass through the urine. Lower fasting blood glucose due transfer of glucose to the fetus. Fasting hypoglycemia. These changes that occur in alimentary glycosuria, renal glycosuria, this will make glucose pass in the urine, even if she is normal. And so we cannot rely on the glucose in the urine for diagnosis of diabetes in the pregnant woman. We have to look for the blood level of glucose. Do you see? We have to look for the blood level of glucose, not the glucose in the urine. Because this is normal physiological exchanges that occur during pregnancy. Next, the fat metabolism. Increase lipolysis to deliver more free fatty acid to the fetus. No, not only this, but the position of the fat in the subcutaneous tissue occurs even in the first trimester of pregnancy. The fat body increases during pregnancy. They said the woman of the pregnant patient got heavier and have fat more than the non-pregnant woman. Minerals increase the requirement for iron, calcium, phosphorus, and iodine. And this, so you have to give the patient these minerals by drugs. So-called polyvitamin. Polyvitamin, iron, calcium, zinc, magnesium. We have to give this patient these drugs because If you cannot give it the drug, the mother itself will suffer from deficiency of these minerals. Water. Salt and water retention occurs due to the effect of estrogen and the progesterone. And so, the pregnant woman is always edematous. Her face is edematous, especially her lower limb is edematous. And this will increase the weight of the pregnant woman. In weight, the average total weight gain is 9 to 14 kilograms. Most of it occurs in the third trimester. Urinary change. Dilatation of the uterus due to atony of uteric muscles caused by progesterone and relaxin. Progesterone and relaxin cause atony of all the smooth muscles of the body, even the uterus itself. It prevents uterine contraction to prevent premature labor or loss of the fetus in the first or second trimester. It also affects the gastrointestinal tract, and so it will cause many symptoms of pregnancy that occurs in the gastrointestinal tract. I'm going to explain it too. Hypertrophy of the lower end of the uterus caused by estrogen together with pressure of the uterus on the uterus. The effect is more on the right side due to the dextral rotation of the uterus. And this is very important because the uterus is rotated to the right. It will press on the right uterus. It will cause this stasis of urine. This is a predisposing factor for myelitis of pregnancy, which is more common for right kidney than the left kidney because of this dextral rotation. Frequency of micturition due to increase of the pregnant uterus on the urinary bladder in the first trimester, and again with engagement, descent of the head of the fetus late in pregnancy in the last few weeks. This exceptionally not so. The frequency of micturition is hormonal also, by aldosterone and vasopressin, which are disturbed during pregnancy. Number 6, gastrointestinal changes. Emesis gravidarum, morning sickness, sometimes with increased salivation. It is a very common sign of pregnancy, and you see in the films and the series that when the patient, when man, if a girl vomit or complain of nausea, they are afraid that she is pregnant. Heartburn. Heartburn, what's he meant by heartburn? يعني pain in the بجسم just below the symphysis the abscess just في الأبر abdomen يعني في pain in the upper abdomen that is called the heart pain. The heart pain, the one of the effect of progesterone and relaxin is to make the stomach atonic. So the food will not she will not empty the food rapidly. Do the food stay in the stomach for 3 hours, 2.5 hours. During pregnancy it stay 4 or 5 hours. For at the same time there is relaxation of the cardiac sphincter, which is present at the lower end of the uterus or the upper end of the stomach. This relaxation will make the food retained in the stomach return ascend through the esophagus and will cause this serious complaint, especially during sleeping. Sometimes this content of the stomach will reach the respiratory tract and will cause what is called Mandelson's syndrome. This is a very serious syndrome. This acid of the stomach, when reaches the trachea and the bronchi, will cause a spasm of the muscles. And this may be fatal for the patient. Number two, decrease gastric acidity, which may interfere with iron absorption, leading to anemia. Constipation, also due to atony of the smooth muscle. During disease, gut motility, decreased gut motility and cause hypergastrosis. Relaxation of the gallbladder with a tendency to stone formation. Actually, there are many other changes fill the gastrointestinal tract, for example, hemorrhoids. Bile and hemorrhoids is very common during pregnancy. Cardiovascular changes. Total blood volume increases almost 40% by the end of the 32 weeks of pregnancy. Plasma volume increases by 45%, while red blood corpuscles increase only 15%, leading to hemodilution. يعني الهيماتوكريت decreases. الهيماتوكريت decreases. Hemodilution causes physiological anemia and hyperdynamic circulation, functional miracles. Cardiac output. The cardiac output increases to its peak at 32nd week of pregnancy, about 40% increase. So if the patient is suffering from a cardiac disease, rheumatic heart disease, mitral stenosis, this will be a big burden on the heart and may cause even heart failure. Which remains elevated, and this cardiac output remains elevated till the end of pregnancy. Increased cardiac output is due to both increased stroke volume, the main reason, and increased heart rate 15% towards the end of pregnancy. The heart rate may increase. The average 80 or 70 may reach 90-95. But if it reaches more than 100 beats per minute, it is not due to the effect of pregnancy. It is due to disease. And so, you should not be reliable on the pregnancy to say the tachycardia is normal during pregnancy. Tachycardia up to 100 beats per minute. More than 100 beats per minute is not due to pregnancy. The blood pressure. Normal blood pressure in general has a mean of 120 over 80. During pregnancy, a slight drop in the blood pressure occurs in the second trimester. Due to peripheral vasodilatation. During pregnancy, the pre-capillary arterioles are relaxed, and this will cause drop of the blood pressure. Hypertension is diagnosed in pregnancy when the blood pressure is 140 over 90 or more. On two occasions, 6 hours or more apart. Actually, if second trimester, you may, you know, if you measure the blood pressure in the very second trimester, you will find the blood pressure is normal. Actually, this normal pressure may be fallacious, because the patient was hypertensive before, but the drop in the second trimester making it look like a normal blood pressure. So you should rely on the blood pressure in pre-pregnancy, before pregnancy, in the first trimester, and in the third trimester, not on the second trimester. There is what is called supine hypotension syndrome. In the second half of pregnancy, maternal hypertension occurs in the supine position when the patient lies on the supine position. The uterus will press on the inferior vena cava and even on the aorta. And so, it will diminish the product output, will diminish the venous return to the heart. And the cardiac output will diminish, and the blood pressure will drop, and so they will make fainting. So the patient usually lies on her left side to avoid the compression of the aorta on the inferior vena cava. The compression of the aorta on compression of the uterus on the aorta will lead to diminished blood supply in the internal iliac artery and in the uterine artery, and will cause fetal distress. The oxygen that goes to the fetus will diminish. So you're with the patient, pregnant patient should lie on her left side, not on her right side, and not on her back. Cardiac changes. Cardiac changes mean displacement of the apex of the heart in late pregnancy due to the force you know that the normal ovary, the normal heart, in apex speed is in the fifth intercostal space as the mid-clavicular line, mid-axillary line, Here, with pregnancy, in pregnancy will press on the diaphragm, will press on the heart, elevate the heart and rotate it. So we get the apex speed will force intercostal space and outside the mid-axillary line. This is normal, physiological normal, not abnormal. Because of these changes, there will be soft systolic murmurs during pregnancy. These are also normal, not abnormal. Functional murmurs are detected and are usually systolic, because actually there is slight dilatation of the heart during pregnancy. Why there is slight dilatation of the heart during pregnancy? Because of the increased venous return. The increased venous return will dilate the heart, because there is increased so-called preload. A preload is the blood that returns from the body to the heart through the inferior vena cava with the superior vena cava. This will cause dilatation of the heart. This dilatation of the heart will cause systolic soft murmur. Venous stasis, pressure of the uterus on the pelvic vein lead to ankle edema, varicose veins, and bilis. We have to stand a lot in front of this. Not only venous stasis, but during pregnancy, there is increase in the coagulation factors of the blood. If a fee during pregnancy is high for coagulability. All the factors, all the coagulation factors are increased during pregnancy. Why is it increased? The aim of this increase to prevent bleeding from the placental site after labor, to prevent so-called postpartum hemorrhage. But this may cause varicose veins will cause thrombosis in the veins, especially of the lower limb. The thrombosis is not caused by venous stasis only, but mainly by hypercoagulability of the blood. Increase fibrinogen up to 600 mg per cent. White blood cells leukocytes may reach 12,000 per cubic millimeter. Respiratory changes. Hyperventilation occurs as progesterone stimulates a respiratory center. Also, this was written in your book. Actually, not that. The progesterone will increase during pregnancy. There is increased depth of ventilation. The tidal volume is increased. Tidal volume, we mean by tidal volume the A. Tidal volume is the amount of air that enters the lung during inspiration and during expiration. During pregnancy, this amount increased. The increased expiration of carbon dioxide will cause respiratory alkalosis. But this is compensated too by metabolic acidosis that occurs through the excretion of bicarbonate through the kidney. In pregnancy, we have mild respiratory alkalosis and we have mild metabolic acidosis. Not only this, but during pregnancy, at near full term, there is pressure and the splinting, the uterus will press on the diaphragm and will splint it. The respiration is mainly thoracic, not thoracoabdominal. A non-pregnant woman have two respirations, thoracic and diaphragmatic or abdominal. Here during pregnancy we have one movement, respiratory movement, thoracic only and not abdominal or diaphragmatic. Skeletal changes. Increased lumbar lordosis may cause low back pain. Why there is lumbar lordosis? Why there is lumbar lordosis? Because the uterus' tendency to lie, to fall. She is carrying a uterus. Uterus means a big vase. And you have to carry this uterus without falling. She has to retract her back and to make lordosis. And extend her back, making lordosis. Do you see this? Without the lordosis, the pregnant patient, named for term, will fall if she works. There is also relaxation of the pelvic joint and the ligament due to progesterone and relaxin and relaxin. And this relaxation of the joint, especially the symphysis pubis, the sacroiliac joint, will cause pain. The patient will complain of pain for symphysis pubis and pain for the back. But this is very important because this relaxation will make the pelvis increase in her diameter, in its diameter during labor. So this relaxation and this effect of progesterone relaxation on the pelvic joint is useful to increase the diameters of the pelvis during labor. The last point to discuss, in short, we have discussed everything in very short. Endocrinal changes. Pituitary gland. The anterior pituitary increase in size and activity, and the posterior pituitary oxytocin at the onset of labor. The anterior pituitary increases why in size? Because the lactophores that secretes prolactin are increased in number. Because during pregnancy and during after pregnancy, there is high level of prolactin. This high level of prolactin needs increase in the number of lactophore cells that secretes prolactin. And this will cause increased size of the pituitary. So if the patient has a small pituitary tumor, during pregnancy, especially if it has lactophore tumors, it will increase in size during pregnancy and will cause pressure on the optic chiasm. And this is very dangerous. Also, the posterior pituitary increases in size. Posterior pituitary secretes two hormones, vasopressin and oxytocin. The vasopressin, which is the cause of frequency of urination during pregnancy. This will occur even in the first trimester. Relaxin is very important because relaxin will induce labor and contraction of the uterus. Not only this, but oxytocin is very important for lactation because the acini of the breast are surrounded by muscles, smooth muscles, that contract due to oxytocin. The contraction of this muscle would empty the breast from milk to the fetus. The thyroid gland increases in size and activity, the so-called physiological goiter. T4 is increased, but the free T4 is within normal levels. The total thyroxine increased because we said before that all the binding proteins will increase. One of the binding proteins is the thyroxine binding protein. It will bind with T4, but because the T4 increases during pregnancy, the level of free thyroxine during pregnancy is normal. The parathyroid gland increases in size and activity to regulate calcium metabolism. The parathyroid hormone is very important because it allows increased absorption of the calcium from the intestine. At the same time, it will increase the absorption of the calcium from the kidney to the blood. It will liberate the calcium from the bone of the mother to the blood. All this what you need for a, you have to have high level of calcium during pregnancy because the development of the bones of the fetus, it needs a 30 gram of calcium to develop normal skeletal bones of the fetus. We need 30 gram during pregnancy, 30 gram of calcium to the development of the skeletal system of the fetus. So the patient should administer calcium, daily calcium, drink milk, dairy, because the fetus will take its calcium from her and whether she has exists or she has not. Do you know this? Do you understand this? Because if the woman is not given calcium during pregnancy and drink milk during pregnancy, it will have hypocalcemia. It will cause osteomalacia, softening of heart bone. Adrenal gland increases in size and activity. Cortisol is increased, but the main increase in the bound motion. Bardo, زي الثيروكسين. في increase for cortisol, but the free cortisol is not increased. Because during pregnancy, the cortisol binding protein increase. Or globin, this binding globin increase. Thank you very much. يا أستاذ أنتوا أنا صوتي كان عالي عليكم طب ممكن نسمعها نسمع شوية منها حتى